Welcome back, everyone. So this time, at least, let me review a couple of things about the last lecture. Things have been moving a bit fast, and we risk forgetting our motivations. So recall, one definition was vector field. Vector or vector field. Let me put them together. Well, actually, let me not do that. Let me just call it vector field. So the abstract definition is X such that X on FG is XF G plus FXG and linear, of course. So X on twice F is twice of X on F. Concrete definition is in terms of coordinates is that X is some set of functions times the gradient. Okay. And these functions have their index up. And this all started from the fact that X, the coordinate, has its index up. However, do remember that X, the coordinate, is not the component of any vector field by itself. However, d by dxi has its indices down. And therefore, whatever multiplies it in an invariant way has its indices up. And X is written like this in one coordinate system, but actually it's written like this in all coordinate systems, where the functions AI of X change their form suitably to make this quantity, this contraction, invariant. And these are all C infinity functions. So the differentiable structure is being used in defining what is a sensible vector field. Oh, wow. Excuse me. Okay. Now, under change of coordinates, so it goes to yi, maybe I'm better off using x prime. So it's an invertible change of coordinates of the kind which you will get when charts overlap, for example. So it has all the properties we expect, namely it's C infinity in both directions and so on those subsets. Then we have that A prime I of X prime is equal to A J of X times del X I del X J, del X prime I del X J. This is an important thing. Now we can extend this to a tensor field. By saying that the tensor field, for which I don't have a good name, but I'll just call it T, is T I1 up to IN of X del by del X I1 cross up to del y del x I n. So you can do this with any number of components. And in the as a result, you get a tensor which has that many components. And when coordinates are changed, the tensor undergoes a similar transformation to this one, except that there's one such factor del x prime by del x for every component of the tensor. So if it has n components, then t prime will have n of these in an obvious way times t, and you can figure out how the indices work out. Okay. Now the second important definition was the differential form. So differential form. And this was basically defined through the dual of vectors. So dual of vector fields. I should have said here that for any point on the manifold, X is in, so at each point P, X is in TP of M, the tangent space. That's the definition of tangent space, is the set of all possible X's, but at that point. So it means that this small X over here must be set equal to the coordinate of that chosen point. TP of M is a different space for every P. Okay, and likewise, it's also true that these tensors at each point, at each P, T is an element of TP of M cross itself N times. I hope that point is clear. Okay. Now differential forms, dual of vector fields. So we define dxi such that the inner product dxi del by del xj is delta ij. So this sets up, this is a way to define the dual of any vector space, and it sets up a product, namely a real number for every element of the vector space and every element of the dual space. That is for every pair, one in each space, we have an inner product, and that's just given by delta ij for these vectors. And then for more general elements, for example, if omega is equal to omega I of x dxi, and if my vector as before was x equals ai of x del by del xi, then together we find that omega inner product with x is equal to omega I ai, and it's coordinate invariant. Now for differential forms, we gave an example by taking the exterior derivative of functions. So D acts on F to create a differential form DF, which is del F by del XI DXI. And some properties of this I wrote last time. So this is a way of getting examples of one forms, which are relatively concrete. That is, to a function, I can associate a one form in this way, which represents its derivative. And from that approach, we sort of see why the notation df and dx are used, because here it follows the rule of infinitesimals. So df, if you think of it as an infinitesimal shift in that function, then it is equal to this thing on the right side, where dx is an infinitesimal coordinate distance. But in general, dx should be thought of as abstract and just a representation of the dual vector to del by del x. Okay, now we saw last time that you can extend. So this, of course, one forms are at a point at P, omega is in TP star of M, the dual space. Now we can extend TP star actually in two ways. One way I discussed last time and one way I want to discuss now. One, TP star M, wedge TP star M, wedge dot 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 wedge, where the wedge represents anti-symmetrized product. So just that symbol wedge just means you should anti-symmetrize. And so for example, examples of such things, if omega is in this space, then maybe I should have a new symbol. Zeta, then it would be written zeta I1 up to IN dx I1 wedge dot 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 wedge dx IN. Okay, and then automatically these indices would be anti-symmetrized. Now the reason we introduce this is that this exterior derivative D works to map. Okay, there's also a name, and I think I introduced it in my notes, but now I've forgotten. I think it's, what's the name for the set of all differential forms? So I think the space of differential forms is given a name. I didn't do this last time, so let's do it now. Of rank N is called wedge superscript N. This thing is pronounced wedge and not lambda. It's not the Greek letter lambda. So wedge N is just a short form for TP star wedge TP star n times. But it's a little more than that, because this wedge to the n can be extended all over, okay, the manifold. So it's not just at a point, it's not just pointwise, but it's the space of differential forms with n indices, I mean nth rank differential forms. And the purpose of this anti-symmetrization was that D is a good map between from lambda n to lambda n plus 1. And what it does is that it acts on objects, for example, zeta as given above, goes to D zeta, which is just equal to del of the components with respect to one more index, I n plus 1. And then dx I n plus 1 wedge, dx 1 wedge up to dx n, I n. So this is this takes an n form to an n plus 1 form. So far, so good. Now, there's another way to extend. I shouldn't have perhaps called this 1. I should call this A. There's another way to extend. Nothing really stops us from considering the ordinary direct product TP star of M cross itself n times. Now, I'm not even sure what would be the correct name for such an object. In physics, we would call this, I'm not sure in mathematics what would be the name. In physics, this would be called an nth rank covariant tensor. And from this point of view, differential forms are a subspace of these, because being anti-symmetrized is a special property. Being just any tensor with no symmetry property is the general thing. So differential forms are a subspace, but they're a very good subspace, and we'll repeatedly see that they have extraordinarily good properties. Moreover, the exterior derivative D acts on differential forms and maps them to new differential forms. But it doesn't act, so D sends, while D sends, this relation is true, wedge n to wedge n plus 1, D does not take TP star m to the n, which I'm writing as a short form for this thing over here, to TP star m to the n plus 1. It doesn't do that because if we are multi, thank you, Dhruv, yeah, multilinear forms is probably a good name for these. The point is that if I differentiate the coefficients of something in this TP star to the n, then I get a new object for sure. But now if I try to transform to another coordinate system, it doesn't transform nicely because the derivative acts on the extra factor. That's something that you must have seen and worked out, and therefore D does not act. But apart from that, this thing is perfectly okay. Okay. Now the original inner product was omega, a one form with X, a vector field. But it obviously extends to a much more general object. Zeta was also a form. It even extends beyond forms. It extends to, let me just give the name just for this purpose, omega n and x n, where this is a nth rank tensor. And this is a multilinear n. So this is also an nth rank. Well, in physics language, covariant tensor. In mathematics language, little less intuitive, but multilinear form. And this is called an nth rank contravariant tensor. Okay, and how do we define this? Well, this inner product simply says that we take these two objects. They are omega, the first one will be omega I1 up to IN dx I1 cross. So you have to know from context whether my object is a differential form or not. Here I'm being more general. And then x j1 up to jn del by del x I, j1 up to cross up to del by del x. Jn. Okay, so this is the inner product I want. And the rule is, well, since these are all tensor products, just take this one and this one and use the standard inner product, delta I1, J1, then repeat for next one, next pair until the end. And so obviously the answer will be omega I1 up to In, X, J1, sorry, I1 also up to In. After the deltas are removed, these indices are all equal and they are just contracted pairwise in the obvious way. So this is to show that the inner product between the vector fields and differential forms actually extends to the multilinear case in a very obvious way. We can also have, we can also do more special cases, consider special cases which are useful, and I'm doing it because I'll be using it right away. Consider cases like, so you always have to understand it by context. Suppose omega is a is rank 2. It's a special case of the thing above, but of rank 2. And we are given two vector fields. Not one rank 2 tensor, but two different vector fields, x and y. Then also we can have an inner product, which is omega semicolon x and y. Okay, in this, what I understand is this is a vector, this is a vector. So both are in TP of M, this also, this also. And this one is in TP star cross TP star. So this allows me to contract by just saying that this thing is omega ij xi yj. It's almost trivial. Well, my components of xi and yj were earlier, x and y were written as ai and bj. Okay, so you can take this inner product between a two form, for example, and two vector fields, or you can take it between a two form and a rank two tensor, or you can take it between more general multilinear forms. The total number of TPs and TP stars must be identified, otherwise you can't contract them. Okay, my point I'm trying to emphasize is it's the same inner product that we defined to start with, this one. Okay, once we've got this, all the other ones come for free. Good. Okay, so now let us start with the new stuff and let's ask the following question. So this was a bit of a long review, but it will be useful. Question: wouldn't it be nice to have an inner product on tangent vectors? That would be a product which would take two tangent vectors, not one tangent and one cotangent vector, and give me a real number. And the answer to this question is yes, it would be nice. Not only it would be nice, but it would lead to the mathematics of one of the most beautiful and complex and sophisticated theories of physics, namely general relativity. Okay, but you should appreciate, I've repeated it many times, that we've got through 8 lectures on topology and differential geometry without having this inner product on tangent vectors. And in this process, we define topological spaces and we define differentiable manifolds and we define vectors and differential forms. And we got by without ever requiring this inner product on tangent vectors. And so, well, now that we have reached this far, it's time to introduce this product. And let's introduce some appropriate notation for this product. So what I'll do is to say that we want, supposing x and y are vectors. Okay, so now I'm going to change notation slightly from now on. It's a very slight change of notation. So vector fields, which were earlier called x and y, will be just denoted capital A and B, etc. And the components will be A equals A mu of X del by del X mu. So I'll use the same note. I could have always done it. But this use of mu, it's not especially natural because normally we use an index I to label 1 to n to label the dimension of the manifold. But as you guessed, at some point, this mu is going to be the space-time index in physics. And that time it will run over 0, 1, 2, 3 or 0, 1, 2 up to n minus 1. Right now, it's still the we haven't done anything like that. And we are not even going to discuss Minkowski space-time today. It will come next time. So for now, mu is the same. Mu just runs over 1 up to n, the dimension of the differentiable manifold. Yeah. Now, I want to introduce, so the reason for this is that we'll have many versions of this vector field and its components. And so it's good to have one notation for the field and its components. Maybe if I rewrite the book, I might try to introduce that uniform notation earlier on. Okay. Good. So now we would like to introduce a new product, which is called A, B. Okay. And this should be a real number. Now, what should be the requirement of this? It should be coordinate invariant. And this is the root cause of the problem. Okay. Because first of all, the product should be linear in A and linear in B. Namely, if I replace A by 3 times A, then the product should be 3 times what it was. This is normal for any kind of product, that if I take any of the entries in a product and I multiply it by a number, then the product gets multiplied by the same number. So therefore, the only thing it can be is something proportional to A mu as well as to B nu. And the problem is, there's no way to contract these indices in a coordinate independent way. I could just set mu equals nu and sum it from 1 to n, of course. Nobody stops me. The problem is, then the value, these A mu and B nu are the components of these vector fields in the given coordinate system. Now, the inner product will depend on the coordinate system. So if you're happy with that, fine. But if nobody's really happy with that, that's exactly the opposite of what, for example, Einstein needed, but it's also the opposite of what mathematicians like. They believe in manifolds having properties which depend on what, you know, on intrinsic things and not on this artificial construction called coordinate system, which is only a tool. It's not part of the manifold. Okay. There's no preferred coordinate system on a manifold. As you know, a manifold is a topological space with an atlas, a maximal atlas, and there's no preferred one. It's just that it's an equivalence class of all compatible atlases. So there's no preferred coordinate system. So if we want to make this coordinate independent, we have to introduce a new structure. And that's pretty, it's pretty obvious what that should be. It should be something which I call G mu nu of X, where this is basically, we define G in TP star of M cross TP star as G mu nu of X dx mu cross dx nu. And we all, moreover, we choose it to be symmetric. We can discuss later why it's chosen. It will come out quite natural that it should be chosen symmetric. So it's really not even TP star cross TP star, but the symmetrized version of that, exactly the opposite of what I use for differential forms. In differential forms, I anti-symmetrized in multiple copies of TP star. Here I'm symmetrizing, so symmetric. We'll see in a second why it has to be symmetric, why it should be symmetric. Okay, now the point is, that this definition of G has the property that G transforms in a certain way, G mu, the components transform in a certain way, so that the abstract object G in TP star cross TP star is invariant under change of coordinates. And the rule of how G mu nu transforms is just dictated by the fact that it's multiplying dx mu edge dx nu, and we assume we always know how dx mu and dx nu transform. So in particular, G prime mu nu of X prime has to be delta del X So I'll write it this way, g alpha beta of x. So this has to be alpha, this has to be beta, and this has to be mu, this has to be nu. And these ones down here are primed because they have the indices of the left side. So this is the precise transformation of G. So G is a tensor. It's a covariant tensor in physics language. It's a bilinear form, if you like, in mathematical language. And you see that it's exactly its role is to allow us to contract a vector field with another one. Now, because this contraction depends on G, it's not something intrinsic to the manifold. You see, in the manifold had vectors, the vector fields, and then their dual space. And the dual space is intrinsic to the manifold. Once the vector fields are there, the dual space is given. But here, this inner product A, comma B depends crucially on me, on how I want to define it. And I choose to define it. I have to define it through some G mu nu. So it depends on that. So I should write this inner product as A, comma B sub G. That's very important. It's different from the inner product of the dual space and the original space. This is a G dependent inner product, and there'll be one for every G that I feel like choosing. And it's entirely my choice to put a G on the manifold and how G should be, subject to certain conditions which we'll come to. Okay. Now, G should be non-degenerate. That's almost obvious, because a bilinear form should have the property, or we should ask for a non-degenerate bilinear form. Otherwise, there'll be vectors whose inner product between each other, with each other may be zero, even though neither of the vectors, non-degenerate means that G mu nu should have no zero eigenvalues. So it should be invertible. Okay, non-degenerate. The simplest way is that G mu nu is invertible as a matrix. I can give you another definition of non-degenerate in a second. Now notice that because we have taken this inner product to be between two objects of the same type, nothing stops us choosing both A and B to be the same. Okay. Earlier, we couldn't do that. Between a vector field and a differential form, they can't be the same thing because they transform differently. They are just different objects. They live in different spaces. But A and B live in the same space. So in particular, this inner product, we have the inner product A, comma A under G, which is G mu nu, A mu, A nu. Okay. And this we can call the norm squared of A. So once we have this, we are allowed to give a norm to a vector, a length to a vector. So until now, our vector fields didn't have a length. There was no way to measure their length. Okay. But now vector fields have a length because of this new quantity G. And now, of course, it's no secret, though I haven't used the word, that G is actually provides a metric. On TP of M, on the space of vector fields. Okay, so the metric is exactly this, and we have to check. So therefore, it will, if we choose things properly. So first of all, remember that to be a metric, A, remember the definition of metric on a topological space or on a set is the same definition of metric, except that we are going to require it also to be C infinity. But if you remember those definitions, one was that A, if we apply it to this case, equals zero, if and only if A equals zero. And this is precisely the statement that it's non-degenerate. If it was degenerate, then there would be some A such that A is zero, even though A itself is not zero. It would be a zero eigenvalue of G. Okay. So this property is a property of metrics in general on sets, and we want to preserve it for this case. Second one says that AB under G should be the same as BA. distance between a pair of points should not depend on which order I take them. So this implies symmetric. So you can see that I've sort of rigged up my G to define an inner product which satisfies the axioms of a metric. Okay, and third is triangle inequality. And this in general is satisfied essentially by any choice of G mu nu. One has to check that. And that can be shown, for example, in a given coordinate system. So therefore, G actually provides a metric. And because it's not a metric on any old set, but it's a metric on a differentiable manifold, it's called a Riemannian metric. And definition, a differentiable manifold with a Riemannian metric is called a Riemannian manifold. So it already has the structure of a topological space, then it's Hausdorff, then it has a differentiable structure, which is C infinity, and finally it has a metric. So these are all the things that are required. Now, of course, I made it look like it's just a norm on the on tangent vectors, on a metric on the tangent space, but of course it helps us to find a metric between points on the manifold. Let me do that and then I'll pause for questions. So to understand it better, let's consider the following. Consider vectors A, let's say, of the form dx mu by dt, del by del x mu. This is A, not A mu. These are the kind of vectors we considered in the beginning. T was a parameter along a curve, and then the vector which induces translations along that curve infinitesimally at a point was just exactly this. And this is d by dt after all. And d by dt is what translates you from a particular point on the curve to the next point. Okay, so consider this case. Okay, now for this, we can have, one thing I noticed is that in my notes, I haven't used capital G for the components. I've used small g, and that's of course also the common usage in physics. Well, both are used in physics, but let's just stick to this one. So the components are called small g. And the abstract quantity, which is small g times this is called capital G. Okay, this is still small g, and everything here is okay. So now, for these kind of vector fields, then the distance between the norm of one of them, AAG, is nothing but G mu nu dx mu dt dx nu dt. Okay, and this is done pointwise at every point of a curve on the manifold. Now, what I can do is I can integrate this along the curve on the manifold to find some kind of distance between a pair of points at finite separation on the manifold, not in the tangent space. So on the manifold, imagine we have a curve which starts, let's say, at t equals 0, ends at t equals 1. Okay. And it's a particular curve P of T, then what I can do is, first of all, this quantity AA is not linear in A, of course, it's quadratic in A. So it's natural to consider the square root of this quantity, okay? So actually I did say here that G mu nu, A mu, A nu is the norm squared. So I'm going to work with the norm. And the norm is therefore square root of G mu nu dx mu by dt dx nu by dt Okay, and this quantity I interpret as, since it's actually the separation between, it's actually the norm of a two tangent vectors, dx mu by dt and dx nu by dt, let's say. This is a valid measure of distance between two infinitesimally separated points on the manifold, because tangent space and manifold correspond at the point where the tangent space is living, tp of m at a point p. I can integrate this along the manifold from 0 to 1 along this path. It's a path dependent quantity. Okay. So, of course, a path dependent quantity doesn't qualify to be a distance because it's path dependent. So, it's not a distance between these well separated points, let's say P1 and P2. Okay. So what I could say is the following. I imagine that on my manifold, I do many paths, all with the same starting and ending point. And I compute this quantity on all of them and I minimize it. Just minimize. Okay. So this is a reasonable definition of dP1, P2 on the manifold. So the metric, once it gives me this inner product between tangent vectors, can be employed to give me the distance, to define a distance between finitely separated points on the manifold. And this is, of course, the more useful thing, because we don't want to be stuck to working with a particular point and the neighborhood of that point. The tangent space is not a space where we live. The space where we live is the manifold. And we want to know a distance between one point and another point on the manifold. Think, for example, of a sphere. I want to know the different distance between, say, a point on the equator and the North Pole. And I draw all possible lines joining that point to the North Pole. And then calculate this thing using the metric on the sphere. And I minimize it. And as you know, in the perfectly round two sphere, I'll get the longitude between that point and the North Pole. Okay. So this is a metric on the manifold, and it can be shown that it satisfies the axioms of a metric. And moreover, there's a nice way to rewrite this expression, which is that it's the minimum of the integral. Now I'll say over the path. I'll just write P1 to P2. And if you look at this square root, there are two dt's under the square root. So if I can take these and cancel them against that dt, and I get just dx g mu nu dx mu dx nu. And this quantity deserves a name. So this quantity has the name ds. So the difference is, this one was in terms of parameterization t of the curve. This one, second one, is free of the parameterization, though in order to calculate it, I have to introduce a parameterization. What you can see is actually the answer doesn't depend on how I parameterize the curve, precisely because this dt and the dt down there cancel. So this is the integral I have to do. And from this equality, I reach the statement that ds squared, the squared distance between nearby points, separated by a vector dx mu, is equal to g mu nu dx mu dx nu. And this is how the metric, Riemannian metric of a manifold, is normally presented. For example, Schwarzschild presented his famous black hole metric in this kind of notation, ds squared equals g mu nu dx mu dx nu, with some particular choice of g mu nu. Now, the important thing is g mu nu will keep changing in different coordinates, but this ds squared is an invariant. And it's, in fact, ds is called the invariant distance. Well, for Schwarzschild, we were in a Minkowski signature manifold where a few things change, but basically the notation remains the same. Okay. With that, I can now open the chat and look at questions, of which there are quite a few. Can we take n vector fields and do the inner product? No. No, the inner product is between two vector fields. Okay, it's like asking in ordinary a calculus of in a plane or in 3D. I have a dot product, I have a cross product of vectors. Now I can have things which involve three objects, for example, A cross B dot C, sometimes that's called the box product, but that's something else. And that may or may not exist. It depends on the dimensionality of the manifold. But for any dimensional manifold, the metric only gives me a pairwise thing. Between two vectors, A and B in general, which could be A and itself also. Yeah. Okay. What is the argument of requiring G to belong to symmetrized TP star cross TP star, Srihari? The argument is that I want it to define a norm on vectors, vector fields, and vector fields belong in TP cross TP. So the only way to get a coordinate invariant quantity is to have a element of TP star cross TP star. It's if you were following my earlier discussion, it's a special case of this type of formula. Okay, if you see, it is this formula where omega ij is replaced by gij or g mu nu. Okay, so this inner product is between two vectors and one element of TP star cross TP star. Okay. In general, the total space here should be the same number of TP stars as these give me TPs. Now each of these is a vector, so it's one copy of TP of M. So two vectors, two copies. This already is in two copies. Therefore, the inner product is invariant. So that's the answer to that. Okay. This G mu nu always exists for a differentiable manifold, not differential manifold. Huh? Please be careful with your words. It's called differentiable manifold. Does a metric always exist on a differentiable manifold? That's a very good question. I think the answer is yes, but right now, if you ask me the proof, I don't know one, because one thing is that there's nothing like a trivial metric. Okay, all metrics can be non-trivial if the manifold is sufficiently complicated. So I believe the answer is there always exists a Riemannian metric, but I could be wrong, and anyway, I don't know the proof. Yeah. Every smooth manifold admits a Riemannian metric. Ritvik, thank you. Maybe that must be true. I don't think the theorem is trivial or something, but if you know a trivial proof, please tell me. Yeah. Muhammad Hassan, the metric we defined before had the property gxy equals zero if and only if x equals y. This does have that property. I don't know why you say it doesn't have. Previously we are talking coordinate points going into the metric. This metric though takes in vectors, that I didn't understand. Dhruv, I haven't, yeah, but as far as I know, GR, so we haven't got to GR, we haven't got to pseudo metric. Calm down, everybody. We are still in ordinary metric. Course is not over. Calm down. Deep breath. Okay. No pseudo metric has been introduced. When I introduce it, I'll tell you that it's a pseudo metric. Okay. Right now I tried to emphasize that the index mu goes from 1 to n. This is a normal conventional metric. It doesn't describe black holes. I'm really sorry I mentioned black holes. You have all jumped to black holes. So please don't go there yet. Yes, Dhruv, we often do talk about, let's not go into this metrizable discussion. There's a whole story about Euclidean continuation of Minkowski signature manifolds, all for later, not now. Yeah. Okay. Could I repeat what I said regarding the length of a vector space? No, I don't think I said anything about length of a vector space. Maybe I said something about length of, I certainly didn't say anything. Okay, maybe what I said was that the distance between two points on a manifold, can be, if the points are infinitesimally close, can be computed on the tangent space, because the tangent space touches the manifold at a point. Touches is just a way to say it. It's associated to a given point. Okay, so in an infinitesimal neighborhood of that point, if I can calculate distances on the tangent space, then I can calculate them on the manifold. However, for finite distances in the tangent space, I can still calculate the metric, because nowhere in this formula did I say that A and B have to be infinitesimal. The problem is I don't have an interpretation of this formula as telling me something happening on the manifold. It's happening in the tangent space because it's an inner product of tangent vectors. Okay, so in order to get a distance on the manifold out of this inner product, there's one non-trivial step, and that non-trivial step is to integrate the infinitesimal distance along a path on the manifold. Okay, it's not that G automatically gives you a distance between well-separated points on the manifold until you do this step. Yeah, could I briefly define tensor product as a map for completeness? Tensor product as a map. Yeah, I did that last time, I think. Just look at my last lecture. I believe tensor product of, so for example, the product of the tensor, so let's say a tensor TPM cross TPM is a map from a pair of functions F1, F2 to R, satisfying this bilinearity that F1, F2 times G1, G2, it acts in that way like a derivative. It's all in my previous lecture. What is the idea behind taking a comma a as norm squared and not other power of norm? So I've said it a few times. These properties should be linear, right? Linearity, you should always bring linearity into your mind. The length of any metric should double if I double the vector. It may be a weird function of, so the metric may be very weird. So there may be a weird measure of the length of a norm of a length of a vector, but whatever weird measure there is, if I double the vector or triple it or multiply it by pi in the vector space, you know that vector spaces have a scalar multiplication, which means I can multiply by any number, then I expect that the norm should correspondingly double or triple or get multiplied by pi. But a comma a is bilinear. It has one a here and one a here. If I take the square root, it becomes linear. That's the answer. If I start with some chart and use the Euclidean metric on that chart and generalize that to other charts with appropriate intersection, that gives a Riemannian metric, Tanmaya. I think that may be true. There are some consistency conditions which I haven't discussed in detail about extending these all over the manifold. So if I have many overlaps, and then, you know, just imagine that I pick some band around my manifold, like my manifold is S2. So I have a chart, and I keep doing overlaps, but then I go around the back of S2 and come back to the front, okay? There's some, it has to match up at the end. So it's not completely, I think, obvious that I can get a metric in this way. I cannot simply say that I can extend it, but I'm sure that there are general theorems. Again, my purpose is not to look at the general case, but to show you lots of examples. Yeah. Achal Vinod, doesn't our calculation still remain cumbersome to evaluate? Yep, it is. I mean, studying distances on a non-Euclidean manifold, which is all manifolds other than Euclidean space, is painful, difficult. And that's why, that's part of the reason why GR is so difficult. Can a norm be defined for T star P? Yes, it doesn't. Yeah, Abhishek, you're quite right. A norm means the length of something or the size of, it's a measure of size. Okay, Abhishek, you're perfectly right, but it doesn't require a separate metric. Abhishek is asking if I can have a similar norm on the cotangent space, and actually it comes out very naturally, and let me do it now. So good, thank you. All good questions as always. Okay, good, okay. So let's now move on to discuss a very important construction called frames. And then we'll see all the things that people were asking about. So supposing I have TP of M, it will have a basis. Now, one way to think of the basis is to introduce a coordinate system, but there's no need to introduce a coordinate system to talk of the basis. I can just have an abstract basis EA. I'll call it A, where A equals 1 up to n other basis vectors. Why n of them? Because it's an n-dimensional space, so it has n basis vectors. Okay. But now each EA is a vector, so it can be written EA equals EA mu d by dx mu, just as a vector at a point P is written. Okay, and it mu also goes from 1 to n, but the significance of A and mu are quite different. If you see, mu is so A is independent of coordinate system. Okay, if I change my coordinate system, nothing happens to the index A, because EA is by definition a coordinate invariant object. It's not expressed in terms of coordinates. And EA mu will transform in such a way that when X is changed to X prime of X, it will change with respect to this mu index. So will del by del X using chain rule, and the two changes will cancel. So the original EA will not change. Okay. However, mu is a coordinate index. Okay. So we see that the components of EA, namely EA mu, have the following property. One, under change of coordinates, a mu goes to e prime a mu, which is del x mu prime del x nu e a nu. Nothing happens to A, no change for A. Okay, but there's another operation, which is change of basis. And this is very confusing potentially, but you need to think about it clearly. Coordinates come from my chart. Coordinates are associated to the original differentiable manifold. Okay, so I can choose coordinates, but objects on the manifold have an independent life, independent of coordinates. That's the whole reason why we introduced vector fields and their dual forms. Okay, so EA is a set of basis vectors which themselves are coordinate independent. But if I expand them over the coordinate basis, I can do that, okay? And then I find that under a change of coordinates, this thing happens, which I've written here. Okay, however, my basis was also arbitrary, it was up to me. So under a change of basis, mu does not change. Okay, rather E A mu goes to O A B E B mu, where this is some kind of linear transformation. It's understood both here and there that the repeated indices are summed over. So it just goes into a linear combination of itself. That's how all bases work. But I don't want to consider any old basis. I would like right away to have an orthonormal basis. So as you know, nothing stops me considering a random basis of vectors in three-dimensional space, which could have weird angles between the three of them, as long as the three of them don't all lie in a plane. Two of them should be parallel. They are linearly independent. That's all that a basis needs. But as you know, we don't do physics by assuming a weird basis where the x and y axis have 33 degrees angle between them and the z axis juts out in some direction. We take them all to have perfectly 90 degree angles so that they are orthogonal to each other. Okay. Secondly, we then scale them so that the unit vector in x, y, and z is a unit vector. Okay. The basis vector is a unit vector rather than being a vector of any length. So ortho is orthogonal mutually, and normal means normalized. So what is the way to implement that? Well, EA and EB are both vector fields. So I can consider their inner product in the metric G. That's what I invented the metric G for, to create inner products on any pair of tangent vectors. And it will be enough if I just require this to be delta AB. In that case, I get an orthonormal basis. Okay. But now, if I make a change of orthonormal basis to another orthonormal basis, this O cannot be any old matrix. It has to be a special type of matrix. And I hope you guessed it. It's again something we are familiar with in three-dimensional vector analysis, not even analysis, just vector algebra. Then OAB must be an orthogonal matrix. O transpose O equals 1. I hope you know how to show this. It's pretty obvious because if E A goes to O A B E B, then E A comma E B is O A C E C comma O B D E D. Okay. Now E C E D is delta C D. So this is O A C O B D delta C D. But this I want it to be delta A B because I'm allowing my change of basis only which preserves the non, the orthonormal property. Okay. And this is precisely the definition of orthogonal matrices. So, to summarize, there are two ways I can change my components EMU. They change under change of coordinates, but the index A just remains inert under the change. It's in the same place where it was after the change. But mu undergoes this kind of change. This kind of change, by the way, is quite complicated because X prime is an arbitrary invertible change of coordinates. It's not restricted to any particular easy group that has an easy definition. It's just an arbitrary invertible change of coordinates. It's highly nonlinear and so on. Okay. X prime can involve any kind of powers of X's and so on. Just think of your change from polar coordinates to Cartesian coordinates or vice versa. It involves sines, cosines. So it's very nonlinear. Okay. So there is such a nonlinear factor in front. However, when I change the basis without changing the, without discussing the coordinate system or without changing the coordinate system, it's this index which gets rotated, and the rotation is by a matrix which is orthogonal. And orthogonal matrices make form the group. So OAB are in the group which goes by the name ON, the group of N by N orthogonal matrices. Okay. So we have two now different kinds of changes that can take place on our tangent space because we introduced a basis and we introduced it arbitrarily, that is at our choice. That basis can rotate, that's the remaining orthonormal, or my coordinates can change, and these are not exactly the same thing. Okay, good. Okay, now since EA are a basis, we can expand any vector field. Okay, I forgot to say one thing. Now, everything I did here was for TP of M, right? But again, we do things at one point, then we extend them in a C infinity way over the whole manifold. So in that case, I get a basis, I get a family of basis vectors, one for every point of the manifold, which varies in a continuous and differentiable way over the whole manifold. Okay. And if you want a mental picture of it, think of your two sphere and think of a pair of vectors, which are, you know, the X and Y coordinate locally. And you'll see that as I go to different places, these X and Y certainly vary. They don't look the same, but they vary continuously and differentiably as I go around the sphere. So it's like that. Okay. In three dimensions, it's an orthonormal triad. Frames have other names like Fierbein. Fierbein means four legs. Okay. And in German. And so it's common in relativity to call them Fierbein. This is fore, and this is leg. But then, you know, people in various branches of relativity do higher and lower dimensions. So they change it to Fierbein. I'm just telling you because you'll find these in the textbook. This means many leg. So this just simple change from Fier to Fier makes it applicable to any dimensional manifold, no longer four-dimensional manifold, okay? So they are called frames or Fierbeins or Fierbeins. All of these are used in the literature. Good. And the point here is that everything gets an X dependence. So now each EI of X is a vector field and EI of X is EMU of X. Okay. So everything I've said still holds true. They all depend on X and they exist over the whole manifold. Now we can expand any vector field over these frames. So for example, if A is an abstract vector field, I can write it as AA of X, EA of X. And these are the components of the vector field along the given orthonormal basis. Now, I haven't really said why I'm doing all this, but there is a punchline which will come in a few minutes. You actually can't do physics without doing this, at least if you believe in electrons, and I personally believe in electrons. So I'll come to that, I'll amplify that slightly mysterious statement in a little while. It's important to do frames, not just for mathematical nicety, but also for physics. But for now, let me just ask you the following question. A expanded over an orthonormal basis that I dreamed up has components A upper A. Okay. Now you can see that these components will change if I rotate the frame, because EA will undergo the rotation by an orthogonal matrix. So A will also undergo rotation by an orthogonal matrix. AA under a rotation. So I use rotation to mean rotation of the frame will go to OAB. Actually, it doesn't matter where I put AB. Can I even put it down? AB. Okay. But these are coordinate independent. But at the same time, I also know that the original A could be expanded over the del by del x mu, which depends on a coordinate chart. Okay. So that means there must be some relation between these things, A mu, which are the coordinate components of the vector field, and these, which are the frame components. Okay. So what is the relation between coordinate components, A mu, and frame components, AA? Well, we simply have to compare. So A is equal to AA, EA, but EA can be expanded over the coordinates. So I get EA mu, del by del x mu, and this has to be equal to A mu, del by del x mu, from which it follows that A mu is equal to EA mu, AA. So using these frames, I can convert the coordinate components, the frame basis components, these ones, to coordinate components. Okay, so that's useful because it really says that in some sense, I'm describing the same geometrical property, sometimes in terms of A, sometimes in terms of AA, and sometimes A mu, and this gives me a transformation between them. So it certainly should be invertible. And in fact, the orthonormal frame matrix has to be invertible in a well-defined sense. And let me write that sense now. So, okay, but this is a useful relation. So this is the first relation. It gives the coordinate components in terms of the frame components. Notice, again, to rub in the same point, that this side transforms under change of coordinates, but not under change of frames, because under change of frames, this piece and this piece cancel each other's transformation. Okay. On the other hand, this one transforms under only change of frames and not under change of coordinates. So these are the important things to keep in mind. Good. Now, a natural question which I could have asked some time back was, given EA basis for TP of M, there is a natural dual basis for TP star of M called small e upper A, defined by, you probably guessed it, we already have an inner product, which is like a God-given inner product with nothing artificial about it, between TP and TP star, namely between the tangent space and the cotangent space, which is the dual of the tangent space. So EA comma EB should be delta AB. Very good. So this relates these EA to EB, and these EA are in TP star of M. So I can expand them as EA mu dx mu. They are one forms. Now in the literature, sometimes you will see that the same symbol small e is used for the orthonormal frames and the one forms, but it's good to distinguish them. So I've kept capital E for a basis of the tangent space, and that fits with the fact that my vector fields were mostly called capital X, capital Y, capital A and B, all capitals, and small e is reserved for the dual basis in this cotangent space. Good. Okay, now there's some lovely formulae that one can find, one can derive. And let's see which is the simplest one to derive. I guess I don't know which is the simplest one, but maybe this is the simplest one. Let's consider, so this is in TP star, so let's take EA cross EA, which is in TP star cross TP star, and let's sum over all A. Now, you should know that if I have some vector which transforms under the orthogonal group, and then I just take two copies of it and sum over the repeated index, then I get, then it's an invariant under that group. So this is invariant ON invariant. So what is it? Is it something we already know? Well, the hint is that it's in TP star cross TP star. And we already know a very useful quantity in TP star cross TP star called the metric. And in fact, one can show, and let's show it, that summation A EA cross EA is just equal to G. It's this G was defined abstractly as an element of TP star cross TP star. And if in components, this says that G mu nu is equal to E A mu E A nu summed over A. Now, if you think about this equation, if you blindly think of it as a matrix equation, then we have written a particular 2x2 matrix G as E transpose E, where E is some other, 4x4 matrix or N x N matrix. So we've written G as E transpose E. Okay, so you can in some sense think of E as like a square root of G. So sometimes people say, it is said that E is the square root of G. However, it's not some simple square root. It's not like anything like square root of distance. It really is a square root in the sense of introducing a new concept altogether, which is that of orthonormal frames. G is defined independent of orthonormal frames, but small e and capital E depend on the on a choice. Capital E is the choice and small e is the dual. Okay, so to prove this is pretty easy. The proof that G is equal to EA cross EA is that if I take EA cross EA, remember, this is in TP star cross TP star. So I can put it in the left side of my inner product if I put two vectors on the right side, and I'll put the two vectors EB and EC, my basis vectors. So what is this? Well, as per the usual rules, on the one hand, this has to be delta AB, delta AC. So the first, this contracts with this and this with this. That's the rule we already discussed. That gives me this. But now A is summed over, so this is delta BC. You shouldn't be too agitated by the fact that sometimes I have indices both down. Well, anyway, it's delta BC. Yeah. The writing these ABC indices up or down makes actually no difference in this context, because we are dealing with vectors transforming under ON, and there's no concept of upper component and lower component. ON is a group that just acts on vectors in a Euclidean space in a very natural way, preserving their length. Okay, so yeah, so this is this. But at the same time, if I do this in components, then I get EA mu, EA nu, EB alpha, EC beta, inner product, TX mu cross DX nu, semicolon, del by del X alpha, del by del X beta. And this, of course, will contract mu with alpha and nu with beta. And this is what I've already done. Sorry. Okay, this I didn't even need to write. I'm sorry. I didn't need to write it in components at all. This actually just was the derivation of the previous line. So it's pretty obvious that you get this just from the property of these quantities. But what is interesting is that if we compute, if we calculate G inner product with EB, EC, we also get delta BC, because the inner product of G with EB, EC is the same as the new inner product we defined today of EB and EC among themselves in the metric G. Okay, and we've taken these frames to be orthonormal in the metric G. So therefore, this is exactly that. Okay, so therefore, EA cross EA has the same inner product with all pairs of basis vectors, capital EB and EC, as the metric does. And if anything has the same, if the inner product is non-degenerate and all inner products with of that thing with basis vectors are equal between this and this, then of course it follows that this must be true. G is equal to EA cross EA. So that's the proof. Good. And it's another easy exercise, which I'll leave to you, that the other ones, the vector fields, if I take EA cross EA and sum to again get a ON invariant quantity, that one will turn out to be H mu nu del by del X mu. Remember, this is a second rank tensor field, and this is the inverse of G mu nu. So in this way, the inverse of the metric also naturally appears. And since G was non-degenerate, it has an inverse, so everything is good. So H is defined by H mu lambda, G lambda nu is delta mu nu. Good. Okay, so quite a lot of stuff is done, and it's 5:15. Now that I've introduced small e, I have another equation which I can use to complement this one. So let me first copy this one. Yep, this is working for me. Copy and paste it. Gosh, good. So this I've already given you. Now I'm going to claim that A, the reverse equation is AA equals EA mu A mu. So it's both ways. In other words, if I know the components of a vector field in coordinates, I can go to the components in terms of orthonormal frames using the one forms, small e. And if I know the components with respect to the orthonormal basis, I can go to the components in coordinates using the frames, capital E. So again, I emphasize, capital E are the frames, capital small e are the dual frames, if you like, dual to the frames, dual one forms. Okay. And now we can repeat this exercise as much as we want. For example, if we have a not a vector, but a tensor field A mu 1 to A mu n, you can obviously write this as A1 mu 1 dot 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 E A n mu n A1 up to A n, and you can conversely write, you can write the reverse relation. Okay. Similarly, if you have forms or more generally tensors in the tensor product of TP stars, you can also make similar expansions. Basically, if you watch out for the indices, it becomes clear what to do. For example, if omega is a one form, then obviously it can be expanded over the basis of one forms, which is up E upper A. So omega is omega A EA. Okay, but this is also omega mu dx mu, and EA is EA mu dx mu. So if you compare these expressions, you get that omega mu is omega A EA mu. So you get similar things, but the way the indices contract are slightly different. So in particular, it's reverse of the above. This one says that if I want to go from the dual frame components, dual frame components to the coordinate components, I need to use the dual frame, the dual frames. Okay. While here, these were the frame components of a vector field, and I needed to use the frames to go that way and dual frames to come back. Here, I use the dual frames to go from these components to coordinate components, and then the original frames to come back. It's no big deal to show that omega A similarly is E A mu omega mu. So we have a nice set of four equations and then their generalization to arbitrary tensor fields, which allow us to go back and forth between anything which is a form or anything which is a tensor field back to the frame components. And the nice thing is that in this process, you essentially get rid of the coordinates. But so by going to frame components, which I've called AA or omega A, etc., we avoid talking about coordinates. So basically what has happened is these objects are scalars now under coordinate transformation. We have converted them to scalars. Now just for a moment, if you think in field theoretic language, A mu of x is a field, AA of x is also a field, but they're not the same function because EA mu of x is a field also. Okay, so the function, the configuration A mu and AA are not the same in the presence of orthonormal frames, non-trivial frames, which are x-dependent frames. Okay. So we avoid talking about coordinate system. So fields become scalars. Tensor fields become scalars. Okay. But the price, there's always a price. We have to account for ON rotations. Because my choice of frame, orthonormal frame, was arbitrary up to an ON rotation. You see, if I have to choose a basis for the tangent space at a point, the only arbitrariness is the ON rotation. Because whatever frame you choose, as long as it's orthonormal, I can find an ON rotation which will bring it to my frames. That's almost an obvious property of ON, that however they are oriented, I simply have to rotate them, and ON allows me to carry out any rotation I feel like in n-dimensional space. So there'll be some ON which will bring it back to mine. Okay. So the only ambiguity then is ON rotations, which is much easier to deal with than general coordinate transformations. Now I'll just take questions, and in the last 5 minutes, which will really be 5 minutes, I'll explain why this is crucial to study fermions on a manifold. I'm anticipating that we'll go to pseudo-Riemannian manifolds at some point, but right now I'll just try to show you what where fermions come into this story. There's only one question. Wow. No, not first and second fundamental forms. No, Achal Vinod. These are just metric and inverse metric components. Okay. These are not forms. They are not actually anything intrinsic. They are the components of the metric and the inverse of the components of the metric. It's a very lowbrow kind of thing. Okay. Good. So given that lack of questions, I have 8 minutes to tell you about fermions. Okay. Now, anticipating, maybe we should do it now. Okay. In physics, now we can apply this to statistical systems on curved space. Supposing I want to study a spin system where it's not on a 2D plane, but it's on the surface of a sphere or torus. My spins are on that, and I want to study their critical behavior using path integral and transfer matrix. Then I'll need this formalism, at least some aspect of it, particularly if my space is not a nice simple sphere where I might be able to get by with a little bit of cheating. But supposing it's some wavy kind of space, then it has a non-trivial metric, and I need all the formalism I've developed. But the space is a space. But in physics, we also deal with space-time. And although Einstein found the mathematics of space, namely of differentiable Riemannian manifolds, ready-made for him to use, it wasn't applying to space-time, and nobody had the idea that it should. Mathematicians even today will refuse to agree that your space-time metrics are Riemannian metrics for an obvious reason. So to go to space-time, we admit. So for that, let's define signature of the metric G equals the signs of the eigenvalues of G mu nu. Now, of course, G mu nu is referred to some particular frame, but in that frame, it will have non-zero eigenvalues, and they'll be real because it's a real symmetric matrix and it's non-degenerate. So no eigenvalue can be zero. Now, however, if you have a coordinate transformation from one chart to another, it's possible for the signs to flip. Okay, so there has to be some kind of understanding that we do coordinate transformations which throughout preserve the orientation of your original patch. But supposing that's done, let's just paper over that. Then we have the signs of the eigenvalues. And in a normal, in a spatial manifold, the signs, the signature is just plus, 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 all plus. Okay. And that's why G obeys the metric axioms. And DS in Euclidean space, DS is a general quantity measuring in infinitesimal distance. It is root G mu nu dx mu dx nu. But at least, in this signature, it just measures the distance between two points in a conventional space. Okay, so it's really a distance. But Einstein changed the rules, saying that ds is going to be now associated with the space-time interval between events. So ds squared is now basically in flat space, in special relativity, it's minus c squared dt squared plus dx squared plus dy squared plus dz squared. And this minus changes everything. So this, if you see this metric, and if you put c equals 1, then the signature is minus 1, 1, 1, 1. Okay. Now, this is not a Riemannian metric, and it doesn't obey the axioms of a metric, not all the axioms. It's called a pseudo-Riemannian metric. And pseudo is because of the change of that sign. And the problem is, well, d of a comma a equals 0 no longer implies that the vector a is 0. In fact, light signals satisfy ds squared equals 0, as you can see from this equation. But that doesn't mean that there are signals between a point and itself. Two well-separated points still have ds squared equals 0, not allowed for a metric, only allowed for a pseudo-Riemannian metric, not allowed for a Riemannian metric. So a little bit, we have to stumble along and pick up, you know, whatever theorems we can prove with a pseudo-Riemannian metric. We have to generalize Riemannian geometry to pseudo-Riemannian geometry. And to my understanding, historically, a lot of that work was done by physicists. And the most, some of the most notable names I can think of are Penrose and Hawking. Okay, their book Space-Time Physics is one of the first detailed expositions of pseudo-Riemannian geometry, if you want to think of it that way. Of course, it's all phrased in very mathematical language, but about physical problems like formation of objects, collapse of objects, propagation of signals, causality, and so on. But anyway, this is the fact. Okay. Now, I don't have anything more to say about pseudo-Riemannian metric. It's just, you just have to accept that that's how this gets applied in physics. I hope it became clear in the last lecture that this doesn't affect the structure of the differentiable manifold. Okay, as a differentiable manifold, it doesn't know, it only knows about C infinity charts, and those charts know nothing about the metric. You put the metric later. Okay, so in that sense, yeah, I guess Chandrasekhar is one of the people who worked on it. Again, Chandrasekhar did a lot, but he somehow had a particular focus on the astrophysics of collapsing stars, because, you know, he was a mathematical astrophysicist. Yes, I think he obviously earlier than Gibbons and Hawking. Also Oppenheimer and people like that worked on Einstein. Anyone who worked on general relativity had to understand this subject. Okay, so Chandrasekhar, Gibbons, Hawking, Rai Chaudhary, of course, Amal Rai Chaudhary, very important. Somebody who working in quite in isolation in India was able to do a lot with this. He proved important theorems about geodesics in space-time. And these are all theorems about basically pseudo-Riemannian geometry. They are theorems on focusing of geodesics, which ultimately were used by Penrose and Hawking for their singularity theorems and so on. So this is a whole long story of GR, but this is not a course on GR. Now, okay, what I wanted to do, but I'm going to stop instead. I wanted to talk about fermions. So let's leave this till next time, a little bit tantalizing thing. In next time, I'll be discussing connections and curvature. And that time, actually, it'll be more natural to talk about fermions. So I promised you that without the construction of frames, you can't talk about fermions in general relativity. That's a fact. And we'll go into that point in some detail next time. Okay, now next lecture, according to the schedule, is the last, but in the next lecture, we'll discuss and see whether maybe, you know, I don't have energy to give too many more, but one more I could give to somehow wrap up beyond Monday. Anyway, we'll discuss all that on Monday. Let's see what are the questions. Yeah, thanks, Dhruv, you're right. Chandrasekhar, certainly. Yeah, other questions? Are coordinates ever interesting by themselves, or is their only purpose to perform calculations on manifolds? Okay, a lot depends on what you mean by purpose. Mathematicians I talk to, at least many of them, consider the second thing to be correct, namely their purpose is only to perform calculations. They may even say that smart people don't even need them to perform calculations, those which are of interest to mathematicians. However, for physicists, I think the problem is, you know, please tell me how you will locate yourself unless you have coordinates. How will you tell anybody where you are? Okay. So, you know, this is why the word purpose is so important. Let's say that you're having a heart attack. I don't wish it on any of you. Anyway, none of you is in that age group. But supposing, and you want to tell somebody where you are, you cannot say I'm at a point P on a manifold M. It just, you won't get your ambulance. So, you know, purpose, if purpose is to save your life, and I think that's a good metaphor for all of physics, then certainly you need coordinates to specify where you are. Preferably, the other person should be in the same coordinate system. But let's say the ambulance is in another coordinate system. As long as it knows the change of coordinates between its system and yours, which is the given as part of the atlas, it can still find you. Not necessarily very fast, but it will find you. Yeah. So for physics, coordinates are very essential. For mathematics, much less so, I would say. People tell me that there has been a complete reformulation of differential geometry, which almost abandons reference to coordinates, where you talk about sheaves and all that. Well, it's very fancy, and it's not very appealing to me personally as a physicist and a person who might need an ambulance. Yeah. So can you mention one or two references about applications of frames in statphys? Thanks, Ritwik. But actually, whether it is actually applied or not, I don't even know. So no, I can't give you any references. All I'm trying to say is that if you do want to study a statphys system on a weird manifold, you would need the formalism of not just frames, but more generally. Yeah, if you would want to study fermions, you might need actual frames. Okay, let me not dig myself into that. I don't know the answer. Simply, I don't know. Okay, so for once, we are done at the correct time. If there are any more, title of the book by Penrose again. I didn't mention any book by Penrose ever that I remember. Did I, Akshat? What book by Penrose? Penrose and Hawking, sorry. Okay, oh, very good. Sorry. I screwed up. There is no book by Penrose and Hawking. The book is by Hawking and Ellis. Okay, so the book is Hawking and Ellis. It's an exposition partly of work of Hawking and Penrose, but also other work of Hawking and other work of Ellis also, and of other people, the large scale structure. Sorry, I must have misspoken and called it Hawking and Penrose. Large scale structure. Is this correct, no, Sudipta? I think this is the name of the book.
That's correct.
I gave references to many, but never to the book written by me and Mukunda. I did in the first lecture, Dhruv. Okay, it's called, okay. Introduction, oh God, it's changed its name. There was an old edition and new edition. Now I don't even remember the name, but let me see.
Well, Mukhi Mukunda would be enough, right?
Should be enough if you want to buy it or download it illegally. Either one is fine. But it's called Lectures. Very unpromising name, as a result of which it's not very widely known. Outside India, it's not well known. Inside India, I think people know Mukunda and to some extent me a little bit, and that's why it gets some mileage. They send me a check for 200 rupees or something every year, which I usually forget to cash. So this is the book. And part one is called Topology and Differential Geometry, is the part I wrote. And part two is called, it's much longer, Group Theory and ... Structure and Representations of Compact Semi-Simple Lie Groups and Algebras. So that's Mukunda. So that's the book, and it's published by somebody who, Hindustan Book Agency, and also World Scientific. So this is the Indian edition, this is the international edition. ICER M Library, what is ICER M? Sorry, Mohali. Okay. Both parts of this book, nahi, they're not both parts, it's just one book. Okay, thanks all. Bye.